You're listening to the Ask Drone You podcast. You ask, we answer your drone questions. Whether you're here to turn your passion into profit or you simply fly for fun, we're a community of learners and teachers who aspire to achieve greatness. We are
Drone You.
Hey everyone, and welcome to another awesome episode of Ask Drone You. My name is Paul, and joining me today is someone who's been flying for, well, potentially longer than I have been alive, and I brought him on the show today to talk about how the proposed remote ID rules would affect someone who's been flying, well, RC planes and helicopters for decades. How would it affect him? How would it affect those RC planes that he's built up, the cherished memories that he's made over years and years of time? What will these proposed rules do to him and that community? So joining me today is Mr. John McBride. Welcome,
hey,
sir.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you again for having me on the show.
I appreciate your expertise, competitive nature, and ability to do somersaults with an Inspire 1.
That's right. It is on video somewhere. It lives out there.
Oh, we still got it. Don't worry. But John, I appreciate having you on today, and I really want to get this out there because I just feel like a lot of the guys who, maybe we would label them as AMA guys who are out there flying at the fields, they're having fun, they're modelers, they're tinkerers. If these rules go through as proposed, what would the effect be to someone like you? What would happen to your fleet in the garage?
Well, first you bring up two things. Number one is the hardware perspective. So me creating and making and enjoying a hobby that, again, yes, longer than you've been alive. I'm 33 years into building RC, and it has driven me to my career of today to actually understand and get excited about aviation overall, plus building things that help the community as far as taking RC equipment and turning into this. So that from that perspective, there might be a lot of hardware in which I have to either purchase, buy, get, changes the way or the manner in which I now enjoy my hobby of just the building portion, not even getting to the flying part, that I have a lot of things that might need to be considered if we do move forward with this NPRM. The second part is the AMA guys. So yes, I have been an AMA member for 22 years. I have been flying RC much longer than being a member because initially as a kid, I didn't know such rules or such things existed. I didn't know anything about areas that I could fly. I was the kid that would show up at the park and I built something in my house. My brother and I would just have fun flying it around and we'd try not to crash it into stuff. Later on, you know, that's when it turned into, holy cow, I'm building bigger, faster, larger things. And as a being self-regulated, I went ahead and said, maybe we should look into these sites. I mean, I've heard that there's places that guys gather and fly together, and it would be probably better and safer overall to do this at these dedicated places. We happen to have 6 of them here in my local area in Utah. So I ran a hobby shop for a number of years, and so I got to know a lot of these people, and a lot of this discussion is certainly happening right now with this new proposal. So
I guess then that begs the question of what are you hearing out in the AMA community? Because if this is going to have to change the way that you build to buy parts from, say, a certified vendor, whatever that looks like, and then let's say all of your RC planes right now, you know, they don't broadcast RID. They're not connected to the internet. And so now you would have to go to a FRIA, a federally recognized identification area, and you would be limited to 400 feet. And that would be after the FAA approved all these FRIAs. And then 12 months after they approved the FRIAs, no new FRIAs would ever be made. I mean, don't you think that just outright kind of kills the hobby in general?
Well, I think a lot of it, and you know, the thing about putting size on stuff, right? Like the things I build or the things I've made in the past, a lot of that is really relative to how large it is on where I choose to fly it. I don't want to fly a turbine jet that moves 200 miles per hour at the local park. That's just not smart. So regardless of transmitting or showing, that's a, again, another self-regulation of me saying it's probably unsafe to do that. Plus, it could be a $10,000 aircraft, and I certainly don't want to crash that in, you know, in somebody's neighborhood. With that being said, the proposal likely will transfer, I hope, with these six sites I described earlier, hopefully that those end up being a FRIA. But you never know. You know, we don't know. These areas that we can currently enjoy our hobby and enjoy what we do at a safe place may not be on the FRIA list. So what if they all go away and now I've got approximately 60 to 70 aircraft that I personally own and I can't fly any of them at just a site that has to be approved? That could be a really big problem, you know, overall, because we're leaving it to them to make that decision on what would be considered a safe area for the FRIAs. You know, with the hardware side, of course, we have radios that can transmit what we need to. But of course, having to add more hardware just to meet a regulation might be, again, semi-problematic for the size. What if that new little transmitter ends up being pretty big and I can't put it in one of my just over 1.55 pound aircraft? It won't fly with it. You know, is that going to limit me? Absolutely. You know,
well, would it also limit you right now? You could fly in your backyard. If your backyard's in Class G, you could go fly in it all day long. No one can tell you to stop. It's yours. Sure. If we can't do that anymore because we would be forced to fly at these FRIAs as hobbyists that have these that are legacy drones. Do you think the inability to fly in your backyard would hurt the propensity for young kids to learn the dream of flight? And then do you think it would hurt their ability to maybe learn the physics of flight, you know, while flying in their backyard, that could lead to them being an astronaut, that could lead to them being an engineer? I mean, well, what's the effect there?
It's true. I mean, if you look at most manned aircraft pilots, they probably a very large percentage of them had some kind of influence in the RC world. I mean, most of the drone pilots of today have had that kind of influence. We keep seeing this even with the drone racers. The drone racers are, I would say, fortunately, not unfortunately, they go out and fly and they have a great time flying this stuff. But to get their equipment ready, there's a level of programming that needs to be understood. There's a level of setup. There's a level of, you know, all of these components that come together besides just building something to fly in the air that could be, yes, inhibited, you know, by, well, you can't do that here. I'm sorry, you can't test that here. You can't fly this in your backyard. You cannot. And so besides the kid, it also has parents make that decision also. I'm not going to buy my kid something that I can get in trouble with if I don't, you know, if I let him go free nilly on this stuff. So that does tend to be kind of the idea. On the other end, though, it might, and this is just trying to be positive on this thing, not always negative, but it might drive people to try and be more community-based, to include FPV pilot racers, drone people, to gather them in one place and do. Not much different than golfers, golf places, or, you know, we don't just go out with our golf bag, set up a tee at the local park, and just start smashing balls in the middle of the park.
Maybe you haven't been in New Mexico, John.
Well, you don't need signs or laws to say, but there are, you know, likely there is, you know, that you don't just set up at the park and start smashing balls. But, you know, there is thousands, if not, I don't even know, 30 or 40,000 golf courses in the United States. And it's a gathering of being able to do your thing. I'm just afraid that there's not going to be that kind of access if we get a little bit further on down the road, even if it does go through, you know, that they're going to be very selective on these types of locations.
You know? I mean, at least with golf courses, you can build a new golf course or relocate one. I understand the NPRM and proposed remote ID that once FRIAs are established, 12 months thereafter, no new FRIAs are coming about. So that means it's kind of hard to really utilize that analogy when it's really apples to oranges, right? I mean, golf courses
can move,
you know?
Yeah, you're right. You can. I mean, and but you know, to be fair, it's is again about safety, trying to keep people in a contained area when doing these kinds of flights, if that's the hobby side of things, to keep them close to away from. I just don't know how that's going to look. How are these sites going to hit the requirements to be a FRIA? You know, current AMA sites, maybe, you know, just designate some places out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, who knows? You know, it's not very defined.
Yeah, and I don't see the future as being bright, honestly, because, I mean, you think about even the little kits of drones that they have for different STEM courses. I mean, we're in the middle of building a STEM course right now, and you just think about, like, all those little kits that make it easy and plausible for young kids to learn, and learn mm-hmm. and retain information that maybe they didn't even think that they were able to learn. To remove that from the society and to remove the ability for them to use the existing kits to learn all this stuff, the future does not look bright in my eyes, because when we're inhibiting people from learning complex things in a fun way that makes it retainable, I don't see that as a good thing. In addition, you know, you talked about that in fairness, you think it's about safety. I'm having a hard time. I mean, like, I don't know how you expect me to believe that it's a safer environment with the proposed rules. Let me ask you this. Do you think that we could create a safe environment if we were to allow hobby pilots to fly in Class G without a network-based remote ID and without, let's say that their drones don't meet even a broadcast-based ID? Do you think that those drones, like pretty much every FPV racer that's not using DJI FPV, all of those racers, do you think that they should be allowed to fly in Class G? And do you think that we can create a safer environment if all of those FPV pilots are announcing that they're in the airspace through the existing Lance system?
I think you'll overwhelm it. Yeah, for one, you'll overwhelm the system. I mean, we do so many tests here with aircraft being turned on and off and checked and this and that, that all of a sudden you're adding way more manned aircraft pilots to the system, whatever this system is going to be. And it's going to overwhelm it. I mean, how do you know, even if they are flying in Class G, if it's nefarious or not? How are you really going to know that? You know, you're not. There's no way. We have different ways to track people doing bad things and not, you know, whatever, but it'll just overwhelm it. To the other side is that, do I think that they need to have some kind of transponder or anything like that? Well, if you keep them in Class G, apparently that's a very, you know, do whatever kind of thing you want at airspace, to include manned aircraft, you know. So if they're not in that space, why would it matter what they're doing? You know, why would it matter? And if there's no way to transmit from it or show what you're doing, again, somebody has to make a decision that is a bad flight or not a bad flight. And who's going to do that?
And you bring up actually a really good point. It's like, how would we know the intent of a nefarious pilot? Is there a way to know the intent of a nefarious pilot? And I think that there actually could be one particular data point that may help tell that story, but that the feds didn't think about at all and is not in remote ID. But think about this, right? If you were to do something nefarious, you do not want the radio connection between the drone and the aircraft, because then the drone could tell everyone else where the radio is, right? So what is a data point to say if it's a nefarious pilot or not? Well, was it an autonomous takeoff with no pilot injection and went right into a flight route? And then that flight route was beyond a mile. Those three data points, I think, would tell you, like, right away if it was a nefarious pilot, because mappers won't go that long of a linear distance, right? The consistency, right. You won't have the consistent flight line speed the whole way because it'll slow down to make the turn and come back. So, I mean, are there data points to tell if there's a nefarious intent? I think there are, and I think that this actually illustrates the severe lack of understanding from the FAA's ability to know what it means to operate a drone. You know what I'm saying? So let me ask you this. All right. did you read the comment guide that we put out by chance?
I did.
Was there anything in there that you saw that you believe could help hobby pilots or recreational pilots, AMA guys, RC. Were there any solutions to problems that you saw in there, or anything that you liked that you think would aid them in commenting on the RID proposal to inhibit the proposal in going through?
I think everything on there was very, very informative. I think a lot of people in the translation of the actual NPRM, I think that's the lack of what you've got going on with a lot of the hobbyists. It's not the fact that there's some rule out there being proposed. It's actually trying to explain this possible rule. And you did a very good job in that, in trying to look at the outside perspective on both hobbyists as well as commercial operators. I didn't see anything in there that would have been like, oh, whoa, I wouldn't agree with that. Because if you really do read it, that's, like I said, that most people are just throwing their comments out there just to throw their comments out there without a lot of validity behind it. Does that make sense? Like, it's just, it's an opinion, and a definitely esteemed one at that, one people that are very upset about this whole idea of being regulated, 80 years of safe flying, 80 years of AMA, 80 years, over a decade, 100 years, whatever it is. And you get that, you have to have a very guided comment when it comes down to the FAA. And everything I saw, it seemed very good as far as the overall understanding of that. So in your guys' guide. So.
Well, I do appreciate that. And for anyone listening to this, if you're a hobbyist or recreational pilot, you can download that guide at droneadvocacykit.com. Again, droneadvocacykit.com. Let me ask you this, John. What does the perfect world look like? What does a solution to these proposed remote ID rules look like? Because I hear people saying, oh, this is intended to make the skies safer. And I hear that, but when the FAA didn't listen to any of the industry insider recommendations on how to do this, it makes me wonder if it's really truly safer. So what does the perfect world in this industry look like to you, John?
Well, like I said, the idea is to try to keep, for the most part, everybody safe. Now we look at the commercial aspect of this. New hardware that has to be created, new systems that have to be made, new drones that have to comply, new. And because currently, that's what it'll come down to is a money thing at one point or another. And that's, I think, a lot of people are seeing it from that perspective more than a safety thing. Now, I might not be alive by the time we get to this point, but you might see drones flying everywhere doing autonomous stuff. And I am very much
planning on having a heart attack soon, John? Like, what are you trying to say here, man?
It's going to take, remember, just something to throw in there, ADS-B compliance was 10 years.
No way. They're
trying to push this out in 3, So we'll see. Maybe we'll see that. But we'll just imagine that as the skies become a bit more busier with automated things, besides a pilot sitting behind, the world is going that direction. It really is. I'm an old school finger kind of pilot. I have seen now development in which all you have to do is press the button. People don't really need to know how to fly in the commercial space.
Do you really believe that, though? Do you believe that, or do you believe that they should still have innate knowledge of the systems so that they can solve problems when they're on site, so they can solve in-flight emergencies?
100% believe that, but even the development of some of these products out there today are not really putting the pilot behind the seat, if you will. The products themselves are starting to be like that. So, just really quick scenario, you have all of the drone light things going on instead of fireworks shows. That's one person, one man doing, watching and computer controlling the whole thing. There's no more pilot behind that. There's nobody that has to push a button for drone number 367 to make sure it's not going where it's supposed to be going. There's nobody controlling that. So that's our world. It's going to start going that direction. As far as the hobbyist goes, safe flights. This truly has been a very huge proponent in our everyday enjoy our hobby living. I mean, we have rules at our sites that we have to follow. We have rules that mandate that if you're doing something bad, you're going to get kicked off the site. You're not going to be able to stay there and keep operating. Drinking, flying higher than you should, farther than you should. These are already in place in most AMA sites, you know. So not to go too far off on the tangent, but the future is going to be, the sky is going to be filled with stuff. And we do need to come up with a way to track them. Do I believe this is the best way? No, I don't. There's just too many hiccups to try and implement this in the next 3 years and be compliant by then. I just don't see that. But we do come back to the DJI drone, a lot of it being, you know, a percentage of it being used for commercial stuff, but a large percentage of it being used for hobbyist stuff. And of all the companies, I would say, that are capable of maybe creating hardware, firmware, software, whatever it is to be compliant, let's hope that they would be. They own 75 to 80% of the market share, and it would be not great of them to try to create something brand new that would be compliant. You know, it'd be very difficult, and people may just abandon the product altogether, you know.
That brings up the question, though. Do you think then, okay, so let's say that we remove network-based RID, and let's assume that pilots get privacy and the public cannot see pilot location. Do you think that the broadcast-based RID that 80% of all the drones out there already have, do you think that that is a system that would give what the FAA wants while still allowing at least commercial pilots the freedom to do what they have done without imminent threats from the public at all times?
Well, I would say yes, but you're and this is the devil's advocate side of it. You would also still have to create some type of hardware to comply. You would still have to create some kind of hardware to receive, to be able to report what is going on. So such as the aeroscope, you'd have to have a number of things like this to intercept or visualize where these drones would be if they are transmitting in that way. So instead of it being a Wi-Fi based system or network based system, or we already have problems and challenges with that just operating today. You know, we already have those challenges. And if you go the other direction of just transmitting and receiving, then yes, we may have to redo the infrastructure. I think it's the push here is to try and use what we already have without spending a ton of money. And that's likely
Why
the
is it also the
push.
pilot's responsibility to pay for the infrastructure to keep society safe? Isn't that the literal definition of government? Shouldn't they be the ones to pay for the aeroscope systems to see our drones? Like, I'm sorry, but just because I love to fly doesn't mean I'm gonna pay for your ability to see me fly.
There's, you know, and there's so many parallels to how we operate so many other different things that, you know, this just always seems to be like the drone stuff, just new things, new ways, new this, new that. It is fair, you know, it's new. Drone stuff's new, but there's other things that are not new that are still within this fly in the NAS space. You know, we fly things in it, kites, baseballs, golf balls, you know, whatever you want to call it. Things fly out in the world, and when are we going to start putting things on those? You know, it's just today, drones happen to be the big deal. You know, and it creates a lot of chatter all the time, you know. And I don't want to put this in the wrong way, but this whole thing about the drones in Colorado, I've been watching, you know, it's just it keeps coming up in every feed that I have.
It's because people
Everybody's
are
reporting
afraid of
about
what
it.
they don't know.
It's just over and over and over, and by now, you know, I get tagged in all these posts, you know, is this you? Are you out there doing something? You know, of course. But in reality, yesterday we had a plane crash here in Utah that claimed the life of the pilot, and it was a blip on the screen. You know,
No one
it
heard
was a blip
about it.
on the screen. It's a share, you know, a couple of things here and there, but I doubt you'll see any more of it after today or tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, that brings up a good point. What are there, like 12 general aviation crashes per day where people die? And how many drone crashes?
3,000 avian reports, of birds hitting stuff all the time, and they get reported, but that's it, and you'd hate to say this, but it's negligible. It's negligible to the point that it's not even news anymore. Somebody lands a drone in the McCormick Airport, and again, it's all over your feeds everywhere. Everybody needs to talk about it. Everybody finds it being negative. Pretty soon, and like I said, hopefully I'm still alive when this happens, it will be just as normal as everything every day, that the multiple people that die in car accidents, the multiple pilots that die, the multiple things that happen, it'll just be as normal as every day. Currently, we just have to deal with it.
Yeah, I just think that right now we have an opportunity to change the way in which how we deal with it. Like most things in life, it's not about the what, it's rather the how. And that brings up one more question, my last question for you, John, before we depart today. I mean, what do you think the response from the general public would be if we tried to implement a license plate system like what they're proposing for remote ID on, well, car drivers? Let's tell every car driver, hey, you've got to add a piece of hardware to your car, no matter what year it is. You're going to have to broadcast to the internet, so you're going to have to pay a monthly fee to the government and to the provider. And then, oh yeah, we're going to aggregate that data all the time so that when you go 6 miles an hour over the speed limit outside of Vaughan, New Mexico, we're going to auto send you a ticket. How do you think that would go over?
I don't think it would go well. There's this. This is where you're coming into a privacy problem, and that's the final part of talking about this. The privacy, yeah, privacy itself. People in America are very strong about that. They don't like their information spread around, and I've seen
And I think that's good because people evolve, John. People may have a mental ideology. And look, you've seen me grow, right? You've seen me be crazy passionate to just a little passionate, or maybe more than or less than what I was. My point is that people evolve. And if we're constantly aggregating and collecting data on everyone and we're labeling them this thing, well, that also would assume that they could never grow, change, or become better.
And I have seen in my hobby, especially flying drones for fun. Initially, when I started to build these things years ago and take them down to the park and fly them, or fly them with my kids, we do FPV racing. Wait, like this was 6, 7 years ago, that we'd be doing racing with Phantoms and whatnot, and building up machines and having fun with them, right? And at the park, anyone that was there, that was in the general public watching us do it, was enthralled, excited, like, wow, that is the neatest thing in the world. Tell us, like, and you take your goggles off, you show them the screen that you're looking at. They get all excited about that. Not today. Like, I was doing a not a job, but I was basically flying in a neighborhood, and out of nowhere, I had that person that now has, not necessarily a public perception, but definitely that perception of, like, are you flying a drone? Are you near me? If you hit my child, I will sue you. These conversations start to come up instead of the other. So imagine if even though they're saying only law enforcement will have access to this information, yeah, you're protected. Manned aircraft have this information, right? You can look up, you can use an app, you can see where the planes are flying, but they also land and take off in a very secure area, a place where if somebody decided they wanted to go interact with a pilot, they just couldn't do it. Not us. Drone guys, RC guys, we're out in the middle of nowhere and possibly can get interacted with somebody that doesn't want us there, or doesn't, because of that public perception. Give them more access to that information by any means, and I don't think it won't be a good thing. It's going to be bad. And Vic had commented on that particular thing a while back, and I agree with him.
And I will just say that I know it does say in the NPRM that the idea is for law enforcement to have the data, but it is not specific, clear, or direct that it is only law enforcement, meaning it's
Agreed.
mutually exclusive to them, which, as growing up in a family of lawyers, means that the door is open so that, hey, we got this data. Would you like it? So,
it's very true. It's going to be different to regulate it. We're not doing a good job with it right now. So just by putting it, you know, I mean, there is definitely nefarious people flying right now. We hear reports of it. Even me as a commercial operator, as well as, you know, sales into this stuff and especially into public safety that wants some ways to mitigate bad flights. You know, it's out there. It's happening. But who's doing anything about it now? By saying that these guys are going to definitely like transmit and show where their location is, you know, the bad guys? No.
And like, no offense, but I don't see how network RID would help that either, because they would just know to not be a part of the network and they get what they want. So, you know, I want common sense to prevail here, John. I want pilot privacy, broadcast only. Legacy drones should be allowed to fly in Class G. I know a lot of people are not a fan of Lance, but now Lance is looking pretty shiny and awesome compared to what they're proposing. And I know a lot of people out there are saying like, oh, we just won't comply. How are they going to enforce this? And I think that the answer is has that strategy worked in the past?
It's not a good way of thinking. It certainly is not. You know, we do want to kind of help guide if we can. We can't always change the rules. And I said that we can't always be like, well, if they make the law, they make the law. We're just going to do it. But at least if somebody had, you know, especially with your drone advocacy deal, if somebody can make the right comments and change the perception of this and make it actually work, that's what's most important right now. Because I don't know who makes the rules, but they certainly weren't drone people
or FAA people, because there was no risk-based decision making. But anyway, hey John, I really appreciate having you on the show, my friend. Thank you again as always. And I mean, you know, if you want to do your signature goodbye, I'm fine with that.
Well, if you need the hair flick, Paul, I'll let you do it. And I'm out.
Well, John, it's good to see you as always, my friend. And thank you again for joining us on the show.
Absolutely. Thank you again, Paul.
Well, that's going to do it for us today, everyone. This is just another reminder. You've got to comment on the NPRM for remote ID. If you need some help, don't be afraid. Download the guide. DroneAdvocacyKit.com should help you out. And don't be afraid to ask your friends, hey, have you commented on the proposed remote ID rules? That's going to do it for us today. My name is Paul. His name is John. And they also call him Drone Jesus. That's going to do it for us today. See you next time.